Etsy face spell. How was your trip? Would you rather? All this and more on today's Brilliant Observations. Do, 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 do. I'm way off key.
You're not.
You are.
You're not.
I like you anyway. Just say I like you anyway. And then I know like you're
you.
Not lying.
I can't wait for you to be off key. That's when I like you best.
Ooh, then that's why we get along so well. Hi, Amy. How are you?
Hello, Melissa.
Is anything good?
Everything is good. Yay. Everything is super good. Yay. Everything is super good. I don't know how I ended up on this bouncy little gratitude bubble because a whole lot of things went super wrong. And I'm just like, but it's okay. It's okay. I'm happy.
Before the commute nightmare, you had a sublime 7 days in Costa Rica, yes?
Oh, my goodness, golly gracious. Costa Rica is bananas.
Ah.
That place is literally bananas. It is so ridiculous and wild and fantastic and really raw. We kept saying, yeah, it's a little raw. We had no idea. We had no idea what we were in for. We didn't think it was going to be, you know, posh. But I didn't realize it was going to be a lot of, you know, grown old men riding tandem on a two-stroke dirt bike carrying shovels kind of raw. Yeah, it was crazy.
Raw, like all of the wildlife is in our house as well, raw?
I was visited by lots of wildlife. And I mean like actual wild, not like somebody's pet, somebody's cat. I mean, it was like we can't identify what animal this is as it wanders into the house repeatedly.
That's crazy.
Birds, monkeys. There were monkeys in my kitchen. Yeah, there were monkeys. The monkeys ate my fucking food. A monkey ate my mango. I'm not going to lie.
You've said that while in North Carolina. There are monkeys in my kitchen and the monkeys ate my food.
This for real. This was an actual monkey carrying. This wasn't. I saw a monkey carrying a baby monkey. I have
right.
a feeling
I thought
this
you were
was-
going to say a baby. And I'm like, no.
Yes. A dingo ate my baby. Yeah, they took the fucking fruit. It was just bananas. It was literally bananas. So I started to feel you get kind of chuffed up because you're so adventurous and you're like, yeah, baby, I'm doing it. And then you're sort of like, just want a sandwich. I'm ready for a sandwich, right?
You guys have McDonald's here?
I see cappuccino. Can I do it, please? Will you? And then they say, you know, yeah, see. And then an hour later, oh, you want a cappuccino? It's like, yes, I did an hour ago still. I want it now. Yeah, so it was completely another world. And I didn't expect it to be as rustic as it felt. And at the same time, it wasn't all that rustic. It was just an expectation kind of a mismatch, right? What I loved about it the most is that we repeatedly found ourselves where in Nowheresville. There was nothing. You could be murdered and no one would ever know. They wouldn't even find your body after you were murdered. Like, they would just drive you into these places where there was so much nothing. It was, I just can't even explain to you. You are literally in the jungle, furthest away from anything you could possibly be. If you rip your toenail off, as my son did, too bad, we're still walking through this muddy river. Hope you don't get some kind of crazy malaria or whatever you get from ripped toenails in the muddy river, because we're going to see the waterfall. And is there a doctor? Yeah, an hour away. So you don't need a doctor. Just pour some tequila on it, which we did and kept walking. So, I mean, that's the kind of, wow. I'm used to four seasons. I'm a four seasons. I expect
four
seasons.
Holy crap. That is, yeah. That is very Gilligan's Island of you.
Well, I'll just tell you this one thing. We went, you know how you go fishing, open water fishing, right?
Sure.
So we went in the Pacific. And we were only going 3 miles offshore. We just didn't think it was going to be any kind of a deal. And it sort of wasn't. But then did you ever see Castaway with Tom Hanks?
I believe I have seen that one.
Right.
Yeah.
When he's trying to get off the island and he can't crest the waves with his little raft.
Right.
That was our transport to the boat that would take us. Yeah, there was no dock. There was no walking bridge. There was no waiting in the lagoony area. There was crest the waves to take the tiny boat out to the equally too tiny boat to take us 3 miles. So much so that we watched the first boat that was, and it's like a, it was like a rowboat style.
A
very
dinghy,
small.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The first one sank. We watched it sink.
Wait. You watched a dinghy sink and
we
then got
it.
In the next one?
And decided, let's take the next boat
after
we watched the first boat sink.
Nope.
Super sink. Broke their rope. They didn't have a winch. Broke their rope trying to pull it back in. Totally sank. And then we still said, yeah, we're going. So it was bananas. It was bananas.
Did you go fishing or you sent all the boys?
Everyone got on the boat. I don't call it fishing because I had no intention of touching the fishing pole. All of the males attempted and caught at least one fish. So everyone touched a fishing pole. Everyone caught at least one fish. Most people caught more than one fish, and they caught actual fish. So it was a big fishing day, but I didn't attempt to catch any. I did vomit. I vomited twice, and the rest of the time, I felt like I was going to vomit continuously. So it was a little rough, but... that's okay.
I hate that feeling. Oh,
well,
I
went into it knowing I was going to throw up and sort of preparing everyone that I was going to throw up. So it was just a really, really thin, viscous, celadon colored, really light, just a little light foamy, nothing to deal with. And they just hosed me off. I just sat there and they hit me with the hose
every time
I would vomit.
I'm thinking, she's describing what right now? Celadon, light,
just my vomit,
viscous,
just my vomit.
Layer.
It was very pale, no chunks.
That's very
super
Missy
thin,
of you to be
thin,
describing this.
Just like juiced celery, just real thin and light colored. Didn't bother anybody. And the smell of the diesel covered any smell that I could create.
A lottie, so. A dottie, we having a party. We don't cause trouble. I vomit all over everybody. That is a terrible feeling. But if you, dear listener, go to Brillob Squad, you can see some of the pictures from this trip of Fugazi because they are worth it. But that would mean that you'd have to go onto Facebook and join our Brillab squad if you're not among the gifted 100 that are already there.
That's right. That's right.
That sounds kind of once in a lifetime-y. And I think the best part was the fact that your whole family and this other whole family were together for, I know this is weird to say, I think I get this from my husband who told my children for 7 years consistently, even in front of her, go give Nana a kiss. This might be the last time you see her. And then it was, this is probably the last time you'll see her. I'm like, she can hear you.
Nana, are you dead? They're coming to kiss you.
But for you, you have your whole family in one place at one time. And you never know when, I'm not saying it's never going to happen again like Nana. I'm just saying you never know when lightning's going to strike like that again. That's kind of amazing. So to be able to go with all of your schedules, lacrosse, travel, your husband's work, your freelance ability, like you never fucking know. So that I think has to be the best part of your trip. It could have been anywhere, but the fact that you were all in a situation where you were kind of Gilligan's Islanding it and trying to figure it all out by getting into this coconut. All right, dear listener, don't feel so sad for her. She had a private chef. When she wanted a sandwich, she wasn't telling, Brian, I want
That's
a sandwich.
Right.
She
right.
was saying, small man with a communication deficiency in English, please, by the way, you're in his country, it's your deficiency, but please, a Sammy, please, a hoagie, something, can I please, a hoagie.
We were in some sort of a posh enclave, and it took us until day 4 that we realized 3 air quotes streets over there was something to purchase. There was somewhere to go.
Like
so
shops.
We were like, yeah, yeah, yeah. And that place was ridiculously, for their standards, ridiculously touristy in the sense that you would look at these cute little nothing burger, tiny, tiny little outfits that women are supposed to wear. And, you know, the prices are through the roof. But at the same time, they were only through the roof a little tiny skimpy dress that you could get online for probably $20 was there for like $90. So it was ridiculous. And if you wanted to wear it and you wanted a memento, you'd get it. The reason I say that is the food, the best possible food that we could get, you can still pay more for best possible food right here where I live. So it was high for where you were and honestly kind of high for what you get, because the quality of the beef that we were getting was so, it was different than it is in the United States. And we were even remarking, because we drove through some of the fields with horses and cows, and some of the roads had horses and cows walking down them that we had to wait for them to clear the way so we could go. So the beef itself is, I don't know what to say. It's just a little bit tougher. It's, the flavor's a little bit different. Like the local beef, even the high-end stuff, is just different. The cuts are thinner. Like all of it is just a little bit different. So, of course, the fish and all the seafood, ridiculously outstanding. Can't get anything absolutely.
But
so
you don't eat that.
Well, everyone else was. So, I mean, I was having some chicken. I mean,
okay.
Tuna,
I was asking,
tuna ceviche with, you know, chunks of tuna that are, you know, thicker than your thumb, and just everything looked amazing. Whole fish served, you know, with the head and bone and everything in it. And it was just, everybody was really grooving on it. And the shrimp were, you can't even call them shrimp. They were so big. All that kind of stuff was amazing. But I also know I'm not going to order a lobster, no matter how great it is. I've had lobster in Maine, and I think it's okay. And I should be punched for making that sentence, right? I should just be punched right in the throat and then slapped on the cheek.
You don't eat that. You don't like that.
Right.
It's not, nobody expects you to have.
So it's a sin for me to order it. If I'm not, so it's just an absolute sin for me to order it if it's not. So it's silly. So I don't want to keep ordering it and trying to convince myself that this paradise food, you know, works today. Like it's not for me. I have
that with you sometimes, and certain coworkers of my husband's, when they say, try this wine. This wine is blah, blah, blah. And my answer is, it's a waste on me. I'm not a wine drinker. And if you have an edible, I'd be much happier. Like that's not for me.
I always bring it back to my best friend, Janine, who doesn't like coconut. And she always says, when people are like, you can't even taste the coconut. And she goes, yeah, do you? If there was shrimp in it, I bet you could taste the shrimp, right? It's like, if you don't like coconut, you're going to taste the coconut in it. So stop giving me this. It's like people are, that's their go-to line. You're going to love this seafood pizza because you don't even taste the seafood. It's so fresh. And I'm like, I think I'm going to taste it. Let me help you. You don't have to make me something I'm not. It's okay.
For me recently, the thing that you can't even taste when you're intentionally taking it for the value and things, properties of this item, is mushrooms.
Yeah.
I take mushroom gummies, like, because, oh, and now after coming down here, and I will bring you, don't panic, to the farmer's market. Dear listener, I am at the beach during this recording. I am hunched over a microphone, incredibly uncomfortable, but I have a desk coming in the mail, so this summer will be better, I promise. So when I go to the farmer's market, this woman makes these drinks. She has a chai, they're out of
mud
chaga.
Water style.
They're out of chaga, this massive mushroom that she has sitting right there. I prefer the peach and honey flavored one, which I thought you would like.
Does it, talk me through this. I haven't done mud waters. I haven't done any of these mushroomed. A couple of the healthies in my life tell me this is what I need. Get off coffee. You'll love it. And I'm like, do you know what? Coffee, okay. I'm an Italian. Couple espressos, I'm ready to go. But tell me about the mushrooms that now taste like peaches, because that seems a little fishy
to go back to our earlier. It's tea. She makes tea out of them or chai. Like she makes different teas out of them, and the one you put mud in water, like, I don't want to taste that shit. So the mushroom that I get, like you said, you don't even taste mushroom. I have a tea that is peach and honey, and I have a gummy which is raspberry berry something something flavor, and they're delicious. So I get Janine's point. Why are you telling me you can't even taste the whole purpose of having this? Like I get it. So although I have to tell you, if what you're eating is supposed to taste like shit and the dirt in which it was grown, then peach, yes. Honey, yes. Gummy, yes. By the way, did I forget to thank you for your post on Brill Ob Squad where you gave perfect grammar credit to me? I read it. I cringed. I read the next line and said, I love her so much. She knows me better than
me. You've trained me well. It's you're the voice in my head.
Oh,
and I have a lot of grammar
cry.
Training. Right. See?
You're the voice in my head that is both sweet and disturbing all at the same time.
Sweet. So go visit us if you're not on Facebook. And let's face it, who is? Just go there for the group. Nobody's on Facebook. But if you pop into the group, you can get behind the scenes information from us. You can share some commentary and some jokes with other listeners. And I think you're going to find a fun little community. So you pop onto Brill Ob Squad. It's on Facebook. You don't have to do anything else on Facebook except go to that place. That's where all these photos will be. And you'll see the monkeys and the skunk that was in the house. And you'll see
ATV
rides.
Did you just say skunk?
Oh, yeah. There was a super skunk. A baby skunk came waddling into the house. Yeah.
Do baby skunks not know about their spraying abilities? Because that is a differentiation without a fucking difference if that fucker
and
can
I'm
spray.
Told they're more potent.
Oh,
so they don't have control. They're easily startled, and they are the strongest at their super stank. So we are of our party. The majority had gone to this really rickety roaded destination to see the world's best sunset, and my eldest son, who had some distance learning homework to do and has seen the sunset before, decided, yeah, I'm happy here. So we said, okay, be happy. So he was home by himself and knew we were out for this brief little sunset. There's no light anywhere.
There's no roads,
there's no light. So at 7:30, it is as black as the inside of a closed bag. It is so fucking dark. There is nowhere. The roads are not actual roads. They're just death pits. It's crazy. You couldn't walk on these roads without falling down. So you're risking literally, and the steepness of them, I took a lot of pictures of the roads. That's how bad they were. In any event, and it's kind of a joke, they say, yeah, it's Costa Rican massage. Because you get in the car and you're like,
oh,
gah, gah,
my God.
Yeah, it's the worst.
Did you take roadies with you? That's what I learned from our
Can't,
friend from Shoe Pack.
Because you'll spill them. You'll spill them. All. You can only have halfway filled because it'll just bounce right out of the cup. In any event, my son was home, and he sent us a quick little FaceTime of him. He heard a noise and walked toward the front of our little hacienda, right? And he was startled at the same time that the skunk was startled. They scared each other.
Oh, my God.
They encountered each other. And so on video, you have this bagunk, and they're both like looking at each other like, fuck, what are you? And he actually says to him, how'd you get in, guy? And then the skunk looks up, and then he heads to the kitchen. And then the video stops. And I'm like, what? Why? Why did you send me this? So we're like, gug, 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 gug. And I'm just texting to my son, do not engage. Do not engage. Skunk, do not engage. We're coming back. Like, we'll help you. So our thinking was,
the fuck are you going to do?
He climbed into the trash, which was an enclosed cabinet, and was in the trash, just rooting around in there. And I thought, great, he's enclosed. Don't worry about it. Just don't touch him. And then we had 2 6-person golf carts. Of course, the teen golf cart made it home faster than we did. And of course, the teens decided to MacGyver the shit out of this. So they got their brooms with the, they got several brooms.
Boots
and one,
with the fur.
One with the little, the what do you use when you're sweeping with a broom and it goes to the dustpan on a stick?
Yeah.
So they swept him into the dustpan on a stick and quick step diarrhea style ran him out of the house and then dumped him into the whole house is ringed with like these Buddhist gardens. So they dumped him into the little rocky garden area and then he was like, fuck you. And away he went. So they got him out. No stink.
Oh, okay. I'm like, fuck you. I'm coming back in.
No stink.
All right. Yeah. So there you are in Costa Rica with your nearest and dearest. So that's lovely. However, I'm here at the beach with my nearest and dearest, and
so
still
lovely.
I pick up my iPad, and all of my stuff. And I need downtime. I need to zone out. Did you get to leave me the fuck alone time? And how do you even say that to adventure-y people with whom you're traveling? And it so happens I have 3 couples coming down to my house here in a couple of weeks, and I love with my whole heart each and every one. I'm going to need some Missy time. Like, how did you handle that?
Well, I think there were several baked in variables, circumstances that made that a non-issue. So here they come. We are used to traveling together all the time anyway. So we function as a cohesive family unit where the adults regularly trade off parenting of the children. So I treated all
so
of the children on this trip as if they were my own blood, and, you know, and vice versa. So it was a constant shifting and sharing of everything. So that's pretty seamless because we travel so frequently together, the majority of us, for lacrosse. So that was okay. Then another factor is we were having such a heightened experience that all of our brains and bodies kind of naturally shut down. We, you know, when I didn't, the only thing that I didn't do was the zip line. And I don't regret not doing the zip line now that the others did it. The zip line was 1,000 feet in the air, 1,000 feet in the air, straight up over a death ravine, right? So that's it. And it was 13 and a half miles long. So it was, it was
absolutely not.
So it was 9 separate zip lines. And the only way to get from the top, and the way they carted you in up the mountain was on a military transport vehicle. So you're in an army truck that you had to climb a ladder to get into. And then they drove you to the top of the mountain and then they thrust you off of it. And you would disconnect and reconnect from zip line to 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 zip line all the way down. So it took 3.5 hours of being in a harness. And the reality is, if I could get over the terror of the height situation to even remember the experience as anything other than abject terror, I can tell you right now, my physical body couldn't have withstood being in a harness that long. My son, who has a similar medical condition to me, is arguably worse, even though he's thin and fit. He's got proper Ehlers-Danlos. He's like, yeah, my hips were dying. I could barely take it. Because you're suspending all of your weight on that harness. There were no brakes. They gave you a leather glove. One leather glove, and this is your brake. You reach up and grab. You reach up and grab the line and yank it, and that should slow you down enough. And at one point, they put you, I'm being told this. I didn't do it. I sat and watched mama and baby monkeys come and try to eat my lunch while I sat at a terrace at a Greek hotel. Anyway, the hotel is owned by Greeks, so it was like ridiculous, white, Poseidon, beautiful. It was half a mile down from where they drove you even further up. So I had to brave the elements just to get to the top, 3/4 to the top of the mountain for this canopy tour. Any event, the little one, who is 6 feet tall. My youngest is 6 feet tall, but he's quite fit, so he's lean. My middle one is 6'2", and he's big boy, like mama. So he's heavy set, right? At one point, they put two of you on the same zip line and zip you simultaneously because you need the weight. The zip line is so long, if you don't have the weight of two bodies, you won't make it across. You'll get suspended in the middle, and you'll have to, to get to restart
hard
yourself.
Pass. Hard
thank
pass.
You. Thank you.
No.
Let me just, hard I'm just going to tell you, I'm just going to tell you this one part because this is what kills me. So the little one, and we don't know any Spanish, Zippo Spanish, El Nato Noicho, Zippo No, Nada, Americano, 100%.
Solamente Inglés.
Bingo. Don't even know what that means. So in any event, they're standing there and they're laughing and the little one, they harness my younger to my older and they put you back to back. So some clown is going backwards.
Oh, that's
right?
Worse. Yeah.
Okay. And they're laughing because my youngest son says to his brother, he intended to say, we're going to go so fast because of your weight, right? You're going to make me go faster. He was talking just basic velocity.
Right.
To his own brother. And whatever fast is. Oh, yeah. So he looks at his brother and he laughs
rapido.
He laughs real hard and he goes, más rápido. And the guy goes, oh, yeah, I see, más rápido. And they swung them back like a pendulum and pushed him. Pushed him.
So they thought it was a request to go faster.
They thought these two teens wanted to go más rápido.
Oh, my God.
So they swung them like a fucking wrecking ball down the thing.
Oh
and
my
they
God.
The la- and the
oh
end part,
God.
The guy at the end part is putting his hands up to try to stop him because in comes my giant swinging with his feet, woof, like all the way up to the wall thing.
He took
and
him out. Tell me he
rope.
Took him out.
I all I heard was riotous laughter at the end, but they kind of didn't like it. Well, the same thing was happening with the ATVs. There's no such thing as like a regulation or safety.
Dude, it's also 3 hours of, it's not like, let's try. It's let's marinate in. None of these experiences were
you
beginner
say to them,
trying.
You say to them, has anybody died on this tour? And they go, ha, ha, ha. And then they keep talking.
It's kind of like saying, I've never tried Indian food before. I'd like a mild curry. And they give you ass fire pepper ghost
scotch
bullshit.
Bonnet ghost habanero.
What are you doing? They never dipped their toes in. They dove right in.
It was
to every experience.
Yeah, yeah. ATVs, same thing. The kids were like standing up on the things, having the treads spinning out from side to side. It was terrifying to watch because I'm like, this thing's gonna flip over, and they're too young to actually be afraid. I got airborne twice. I almost lost control of the thing. It was not cool by any stretch of the imagination. I learned much later I didn't know how to brake properly, so I was doing it to myself. And all this stuff, you're like, I almost died today. Almost died on that boat. Almost died in the canopy. Almost died. How many ways did I almost die today? So it was a lot of adventure. So bringing it back full circle to you, when you get home from a day like that and someone is actively cooking your dinner and you're sipping a cocktail in the pool,
everything's
You don't need a lot of talky-talky. You might even say, I think I'm just going to go take a shower and wash off half of the Costa Rican crust that is embedded in all my creases and folds. And then when you come back down, if you come back down, everyone else is so gobsmacked, tired, pie-eyed, happy, relaxified, exhausted, brain-dead anyway.
Yeah.
There's no pressure. There's just no pressure. And there's no I've had enough of you. I'll put it to you like this. I carried my iPad all the fucking way down there, and I never plugged it in, and I never opened it once.
You never played Fishdom?
I played Fishdom on my phone, but I didn't play it. I didn't play it on my preferred device.
Good, good, good. Then I'm
glad. I didn't open it. I didn't use it. I didn't need it. And when I would get in the bed, I would just, whoa.
Yeah, but.
And then the monkeys wake you up so early anyway. So when you can sleep, you've got to go. Really, you've got to go to sleep because you're not going to get a chance otherwise. So that's the way. So when your brain is so full, you're both not missed. And everyone sort of is at the same. You're
okay,
all on the same.
Fair.
You're on the same ocean current, right? So it's like now is the time for our brains to relax and our bodies to be
okay.
Quiet.
I appreciate that,
and
I
think that happens on all group trips. The other thing is, this is probably the bigger variable. We get the courtesy and the benefit and the love of seeing each other frequently on these visits to your paradise. Everyone coming in is getting a deep dive. The zip line is your living room. That's what we're there for.
Okay. That
so the
helps.
FOMO is strong, right? You don't want to go to bed. You don't want downtime because this is it. I don't get to see you next week to go to the movies. So that's the reason that I think it's much easier for us to flow in and out, because I can see you whenever the fuck I want to see you in my Costa Rican team. I see all the time, right? My Jersey City, which I know you're not in, my beach visit with you is going to be, I just need to stay awake 1 hour longer. I don't want another cocktail, but I'm not going to stop because I want to see you. So, I mean, it's fighting our own natural proclivity. You know, we gotta release the FOMO and know that there's going to be another visit. There has to be.
There will be lots. You know that. We already have several on the calendar. Amy, if you could be in a room with 50 bees for 5 minutes or in a room with 50 spiders for 5 minutes, which would you choose?
Bees.
You would choose 50 bees for 5 minutes.
Sure.
Okay.
They're not going to bother me. I mean, am I covered in honey? They're not going to bother me or whatever the bees like. What are bees like?
You are with 55% of the community who has decided that 50 bees for 5 minutes, 55% to 45%.
I don't feel like bees bother, meaning, let me say it like this. I hate spiders so fucking much.
Oh boy.
I don't want to be around them. I don't want that.
All right.
I don't want that.
And you were in
the
Costa Rican jungle. So that's
pretty
impressive.
There were some spiders and ants and large insects in all the places.
Would you rather watch Game of Thrones or Breaking Bad?
Ooh. Is there any more context to this question?
No. It's just a would you rather. And I'm going to tell you if you're in the majority or the minority.
Breaking Bad.
I concur 100%. Because
I'm in the minority.
And
I'm
you're
sure.
in the minority, but not by much. It's almost a clean split. It's almost.
I haven't seen Game of Thrones, but I've seen enough, and I know enough, and I know the gist of the story. I've seen Breaking Bad, and it was
the best.
It's top 10 all time storytelling ever.
Oh my God, my son just watched 6 seasons of The Sopranos.
Bingo.
And he's like, this is life changing. I'm like, yes, it is. He said, I need some stupid comedy now just to take the edge off or else I'm going to kill one of you.
Okay, you wish.
Never mind. Yeah. All right. Would you rather win $75,000 or let your best friend win $250,000?
Best friend.
Same, 100% same. And the consensus was not in our favor.
But everybody wants the $7,000, $75,000?
Not everybody. 51% said they wanted the $75,000 up over letting your best friend win.
You know what? I got to tell you, the calculus changes when the totals change. That's totally a totals number. That's totally a totals number. It's not, would you rather win $1 or have your friend win $3? That's not how that, if we're talking in the millions, that's a different answer. Like, I don't know what those numbers are, but I know that when the total amount that I win changes, I think about it longer.
Yeah,
that's just
I agree.
A fact. That's
I agree.
Just a fact. Yeah.
I definitely
75
agree.
is not enough for me to withhold 250 from my friend.
Yeah. I mean, 250 could do more for your friend than 75 could do for you. And that's, I guess,
and
how I would look at it.
And still gets me a nice healthy tip out and she wins anyway. So, I mean, we're all good, right? Yeah.
And she'll take you out to a really nice dinner.
Bingo.
Twice a year for 6 years.
Bingo, bingo.
Maybe. Would you rather stop showering or stop brushing your teeth?
This is a really tough one for me. I almost don't have an answer. I'm going to go with showering. I'm going to keep brushing my teeth.
I think I would rather stop showering than stop brushing my teeth. And I might be sensitive to this one because teeth is part of heart health.
Well, your teeth are amazing. So let's just say
heart history issues that, like, the whole brushing your teeth is inside. Stopping showering is more outside. And I think I could fall into the ocean every once in a while and wipe some shit off. We are not in the majority on this one. More people said they would stop brushing their teeth, which makes my skin crawl and makes me want to vomit a little.
Well, I mean, it's like if you're really hard up for it, you could sometimes take a napkin and like drag it on your teeth and that gets you part of the way there. But it's gross. Your whole mouth is gross.
I watched them on Survivor with that little piece of wood on each tooth because they don't have toothbrushes on Survivor. And they take little piece of wood and they go around each tooth. I don't know if that works. I don't know.
It probably jacks up your fucking teeth.
It jacks up your gums, I'll tell
you.
Yes.
No,
right?
I wouldn't.
Shoves all
that.
The bacteria up in there. Up in you.
Up in you.
Would you rather wrestle a lion or fight a shark?
I would rather fight a shark.
I would have guessed that for you because you're a swimmer.
Well, they have so many easy pain points. You just punch them dead on the nose, right? So it's like I know what to do when that guy's coming at me to kill me. A lion can overpower me in all of the ways. I cannot run him.
Right.
I cannot fight him. I cannot bite him.
Climb him.
I cannot punch him. Can't go over it. Can't go through it.
You're going to go through him. You're gonna go right going to go right
on a lion hunt.
And right out his ass. You're going right through him. More people, this is fucking shocking to me. More people said they would wrestle a lion over fighting a shark. I heard fighting a shark is as simple as punching him between his eyes. I can't swim.
I don't know that I love the word simple, but I agree with you. There's a path. there's a path to success.
There is no path with that
there's
lion.
There's no path to success with the lion. And I say this as Leo the lion, right? I fully understand my
Leo.
Lack of path. All right.
Would you rather cross a river with piranhas or cross a river with crocodiles?
Oh,
never
fuck.
Smile at a crocodile.
That's not an easy one either.
Talk a while.
Crocodiles.
I don't know enough about piranhas. I just know that in Wednesday, the...
It looked really upsetting.
It was devastating. They
it
ate
looked
the
really
shit
upsetting.
Out of that
I feel
guy.
Like piranhas are probably not as big a problem as everybody says they are. But I also feel like crocodiles... If you time it right,
you can
when they're lazy and it's very sunny
or
and they're just
fed.
Not interested. And I can also, I see where they are and my suspicion is there's fewer of them. I mean, because the real answer is C, empty river. Like that's actually D, boat. That's my preferred answer. So, it was a straight 50-50, guys.
It was a straight 50-50.
Nobody could decide. Gringo die in river. Yes.
Would you rather watch TV all day or sleep all day? To me,
TV.
They're the same.
TV. Not the same at all. TV all day. TV.
To me, I could put on Seinfeld in the morning. I can wake up, fall asleep. I'm still happy that what I'm watching and I sleep.
I don't love sleeping all day. I don't even love the sound of it when we're talking about it in a fantasy context right now. When I hear sleep all day, all I think is sickness.
That's true. And sleeping all day does not recharge you. I think for me, it makes me so much more tired.
Bingo. Totally correct. Yes,
for me,
yes.
I think it took until my late 40s to discover that movement is medicine, that laying there and watching TV would probably kill me, or laying there and sleeping would probably kill me too. And people agreed, because this is a Netflix streaming society, 53% said they would rather watch TV all day.
I've done that too. So
I'm going to give you one last one. There are others, but I'm going to end it here. Would you rather know how the world began or know when the world would end?
Would rather know when the world would end.
You are not alone. 58% of people would rather know that as well. And that to me was a little surprising.
I feel like I have a good bead on when the world began, though.
Yeah, I guess if you follow science. But who follows science these days?
Some fuckers have been looking back, and, you know, Neil deGrasse Tyson is very confident in himself. So, I mean, somebody's done something. And also, we're here now. It's really more about, do I need to keep saving for retirement? Because if it's coming up in the next couple months, I have some places to go. Like, that's what I'm thinking.
Amy.
Ma'am.
I was talking with a mutual friend of ours who out somewhere, and someone said, she saw people, she was in public, and someone said to someone else, this is a conversation she overheard, "You look fantastic." And the woman said, "Oh, thank you so much." She said, What are you doing? Like, what's going on? How, what did this? You look, let me reiterate, fantastic." And the woman says, "Oh, it's just an Etsy face spell."
Okay. This is not a friend of mine.
It is.
Nope. You're wrong.
It
that's
is.
Not a, that
she
can't,
wasn't
that's
in
not,
the conversation. She
not,
overheard it.
Wait, did my friend have an Etsy face beautification spell?
No.
Done upon her?
She just overheard this story.
So she was in the environment.
Correct.
Of an Etsy Wicca beauty.
So okay. I said, "No. Shut up. Like, what? No, what? No." And she said, "Seriously, Etsy now has to crack down on witchcraft."
Okay, got it. Why?
What? Because they're being sued over fraud for people who go on Etsy and purchase spells that don't work.
That just seems to be a contract problem. That's not an Etsy problem. But I get it.
What do you get? There's an Etsy face spell? What is happening? How did I miss it? And how stupid are people that they are paying third party online?
I don't think people are stupid at all.
All right, first of all,
I'm highly
that's not
curious.
True.
I'm highly curious. Fucking fair. Fair point. Okay, thank you for catching me up. In that context, here's
please.
Etsy face spell
please.
in a nutsack for you. You
please.
Ready? Okay, here it comes. If you are feeling pain and the doctor says to you, "I know exactly what that is. You're going to take 4 of these. You're going to go to sleep, drink a tall glass of water. And if it still hasn't gone away, you come back and see me. But I will be amazed if it hasn't gone away." And you go, and after the first pill, it's gone. And that pill is called a placebo. And that, my friend, is the same as an Etsy Wicca face. And I don't mean to keep saying Wicca. But I lump all positive vibey, witchy, hooby dooby into one area. And so, yeah, if somebody wants to tell you I can snap my fingers and make you believe your face is more beautiful, just like Tom Robbins did to Jack Black in that Banana Hands movie, go for it. And you know what? If it does look more beautiful to you at the end of the day, it's worth your $42. Don't you think?
Are you talking about Shallow Hal?
Oh my God, you pulled that right out of the depths of your innocence.
Banana Hands. He is enormous. How does he not have Marfan syndrome?
It's like
he
shaking a bunch of bananas.
The
yeah.
biggest fucking dude in the world. wow. Holy boob leg. Okay. You're saying this phenomenon on Etsy is the placebo of here's a spell, say this five times. It's a you will manifest this and that will be it.
Well, I don't want to lump it into manifesting, but I also
because
agree.
Manifesting works.
Yes. Okay. It does. Honey, manifesting works whether math is math, whether you believe it or not.
I don't disagree with you. I'm saying an Etsy face spell is such obvious bullshit. How?
Well, because here's why. Here is the truthiness in your bullshit stew, as it were. Okay. And truthiness is an ingredient in the Etsy bullshit stew because beauty is an inside job. Beauty is an inside job.
Is this the eye of the beholder thing coming at me again?
Maybe, but from reverse. Beauty is an inside job. You are beautiful when you believe it, when you feel beautiful. You radiate beauty. It's an inside job when you are happy, when you are joyful, when you are grateful. This is just the fucking truth. Your face, and when people say, you know, smile, you look better, that's a super dickhole thing to say. And the reality is, it's also true. No one else can make you smile because they command it or will it. When you bring your own joyful, authentic, genuine, natural smile to the party of your life, you light up, you show up for yourself and for others completely differently. And that energy, that vibe, that presence, that appreciation for being right there with everybody in the moment changes everything around you. And that fuels and feeds you as well. So it is a positive, virtuous circle that all begins with your belief that you look great. And if your belief for looking great starts by paying some shysta an extra $60 to say, but you already look right. You know, take these totes. The thing has got to work. No chance in hell. Like whatever the thing is that they're going to do, right? Whatever it takes to get you over that hump and get things rolling, go for it. What value is money if not to make yourself happy? Yes?
So where I take
issue.
There's
my witchy laugh. I didn't mean for it to be so on the broomstick, but fuck you.
Where I take issue is there are, yes, that's wonderful. If you feel you radiate, and we talked about this last time when we talked about your clothes. We talked about how you walk into a room and you light it up because you are joy in a room. My objection to this theory, this plot line, is that there are people who are sad and desperate who happen to have cash. And there are other people who take advantage of that. To me, this is on par or similar to somebody calling up a relative of Stewart's or sending an email saying, we need money to help blah, blah, blah. You have to send this to us. And they get scammed out of $15,000. They were trusting and open, large-hearted, and wrote a check and got scammed. Is it how is it different getting scammed with this face spell?
There is no fundamental difference in this scam as there is in any other scam. What I'm presenting to you is that 100% of face spells for sale on Etsy are not scams. 100% are not a scam. Are there some among that number that are purely, I'm just going to write face spell. I'm not going to do anything. I'm not even going to give you a sentence. I'm not even going to bother going to an AI generator, ChatGPT, and pull up something. I'm not going to do a single thing. I'm just going to take your money and give you nothing in return. Like, there are some, yeah, there are criminals out there, people trying to scam you for sure. But I also believe that, and this is going to be a this will make your head explode even further. So hang on to your ass flaps. Here we go.
Okay.
I also believe and agree that if you take huge value in faith, and you want to give money to those organizations like the Joel Preacher, whatever his name is, right? Prosperity
Osteen.
Gospel.
The Osteen
yes,
guy?
Yes, yes. That's a Taylor Swift concert for believers. And does Taylor Swift deserve $1,200 to sing you songs for 4 hours? Abso-fucking-lutely, because it changes your worldview. You love it. right? So how is she less of a scam than Dr. Joel or whatever his fucking name is, Preacher Steen, standing up there and saying, everybody's happy, the Lord wants you to have a big old car, my carpets are clean, or whatever his fucking thing is.
He says, the Lord wants me to have a G6, so okay. Give me money so I can buy a G6.
He doesn't, I don't know what he says in fairness, but I will say this to you. If you're sitting there and the thing that he's saying to you, if you're on Etsy and the thing that you're buying actually makes you feel beautiful, even for a moment, then what you've done is traded a little bit of money for a little bit of feeling. That's a transaction. That's commerce at its finest. Because frankly, the same pair of shoes that you bought is no different. It's really no different. The function is so much lower down than the emotional connection of the transaction. So I'm kind of okay with it, but I also am not thinking about people being preyed upon in the sense that they're vultures out there stealing, wantonly stealing and ripping people
right,
off.
Because
like, that's
one
not
of those,
in my, yeah.
Right. One of those was a $15,000 and one was a $40 spell. So are you saying that the fraud, which I'm claiming it to be, is okay on a smaller level if it brings a hint of joy, but once you hit that, like, you don't think that relative of my husband's thought I did something good and we were all like, are you out of your fucking mind? You just lost 15 grand. You need that money. You're a certain, whatever. Like,
well, I mean, there's so many layers and levels to this. The entire conversation began with, you look lovely. You look transformed. I see a change. I see a result. Everything that you've just said freely, unencumbered, and totally unaware of this transaction reinforces the validity of the transaction.
Of the spell, right.
So there's that. So there's that. There was a functional result. That's number one. Number two, another thing that's going to blow your head off your body, Tom Cruise, who you perhaps rightly hate.
Loathe, yeah, yeah.
Okay, I suspect without any information at all, welcome, I'm back.
It doesn't stop
I know
us.
Without
Go
any
ahead.
Evidence.
Yeah.
His participation in Scientology equals a massive lifetime investment in financial investment in Scientology that on some level is a bargain where I pay this tithe or donation or fee or membership or whatever. I pay this and I see a direct result in my career. And those who stop paying and those who exit also see huge downfall. So it is a psychological, it is a cult. It's 100% a cult, Scientology. But it's also, there's gambler psychology going on. I mean, if I do this, it's superstition. It's all of these things that there are so, every purchase involves the same kind of mental trickery. It's how overt and elaborate are you accepting it to be? We do it in the Gucci store is what I'm saying. So I kind of say let the free commerce reign, right?
I feel like there's a dubious hand being played in the fact that Etsy has to crack down on witchcraft. And that's a sentence that came out of my girlfriend's mouth about what they have to do legally. They have to say things like, you cannot sell, blah, blah, blah. Like, look it up. It is crazy what they're having to go through now because I think it's because people feel out of control and this is a magic pill. This is an answer. This is a
emphasis on magic.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's a pill is not the answer. A spell is not the answer. Whatever it is with which you are having trouble or needing, it's nothing's easy like that.
I don't know. It all comes back to you can't sell snake oil, but you can get a gun. So there's a lot of things in the rotation that
good
maybe need
Lord.
To be addressed.
So here we are at this stage of our lives, knowing not to get an Etsy face spell.
Yes, please.
I have two children who are high school graduates. You have Yay! Two children who are high school graduates. It happened, right? I mean, I watched your Facebook and your husband's Facebook like it was really the last
the past
seconds.
2 weeks. The past 2 weeks could have been 2 years long. So much has happened in the past 2 weeks. I can't even get my head around it. And our middle baby has not only successfully graduated, but had a high old time doing it and is just king of the world and had such a bumpy road getting there. It was a little bit like, literally, Costa Rica is the great analogy. The roads are impassable. They are ridiculous. They will shake your liver out of your fucking body. And then as soon as the vehicle stops, you're presented with the best view of paradise on our planet. And that's where we are with him, right? It was a very bumpy road. And now we're at this level where it's nothing but good. And I guess careening to your death on a handbrake zip line. Yeah. So I don't know what's next, but he's in a good place.
You do know what's next. He's accepted to his first choice college this summer. He is working, not working.
He has his choice of jobs and we're trying to decide which one he's going to do or even whether he's going to do it. He's the type that needs a job. I've been very anti get a job for my kids because school is your job and school and extracurriculars are such a job for you. I kind of want you to have 2 or 3 months of downtime that you'll never get again. You know, let's just sit and loaf. But for him to sit and loaf would be really kind of backpedaling and disastrous. So I think he is going to go be productively employed and, you know, do the thing.
I'd like to recommend a job at a bakery for him. Because when my son had a job at a bakery.
Worked out for all of you.
I was never happier. I had these croissants left over at the end of the day. This baguette was going to go in the trash. I'm like, better my mouth.
Oh, thank you.
All right, 11 pounds later.
I know right where to put that.
Yeah. Right where to. And next week, cruising up to when She Podcast was scheduled IRL to take place, and a shoe dropped, and it was made virtual in addition to providing space at PodFest, I want to say, in Orlando, Florida.
Yeah, so it's still going to happen on the same dates. They're going to do it virtually now. And then there is a second sister event that is included in the thing.
That's
that happens
awesome.
In January. So,
and who doesn't want to go to Orlando in January wearing things rainbow and stand with your fist in the air with pride?
Super inclusive. It's going to be great. It's going to be great. I'm actually looking forward to the virtual She Podcast more than I was looking forward to the live She Podcast, because those things are just a sensory overload, and virtual you actually learn more.
Well,
so if you're going to learn, that's the better way to do it.
You also don't get all of the experience. You said it. It is an overload. So if you are there and 7 rooms are full of all the things that are happening and the people with whom you want to catch up and is that so-and-so from whereabouts? And you never even get to the learning part because
it's a three-ring circus. You can never be in 3 rings at the same time.
Correct.
So this is a way to actually make that happen. And I feel like I just continue to say I'm looking forward to it more. This seems like a better and easier and an exciting. As an attendee, I love it.
I think it's the best of both worlds because you can get the onlineness and you can keep and save and look back to and archive. When in reality, it happens in such a rush. You're like, wait, what the? Oh, my God. I have been listening to people who come back from Taylor Swift's Eras Tour saying they have experience amnesia. This is a thing.
What was that?
So much. Nobody took a picture. No videos. They had so much enrichment, so much stimuli in the room.
Yeah.
That they couldn't
process
in their brain and keep a memory. They said, I'm sure she played that. I don't remember all of the things. They can't remember things. And I think they're high. And then the reporter goes, I know you're thinking that they were just high. And I'm like, I was. That's exactly what I was. She said, no, we've talked to these neuroscientists and they say it is a phenomenon that the brain is not capable of holding on to because there is so much and it's at such a heightened level that the so much is coming so fast and so high, there's my high, that they cannot keep them as memories.
That's exactly. I've lived that many times in my life, and it's tough. It's tough to keep up with that amount of processing. And you physically can't. You get to a point. There's also decision fatigue, which we've talked about the same in prior shows. Same scenario. Your brain can do it, and then it's like, okay, tap out. Give somebody else a chance.
That's all the room I have.
Yeah. I'm recharging, recalculating. Yeah.
Recurating. So I get this text from my kid, oldest, and he says, I have an opportunity. And I said, take it. wait, what's the opportunity? Like,
sounds like me. I'm in. What is it?
Exactly. Here's $5. What did I just buy? He was asked to go work the Taylor Swift concert in.
Oh, for fuck's sake. Yes.
Pittsburgh. Yeah, in a couple of weeks. So I was like, yo. And I was asked if I could bring my sister, if I knew someone else. Both of my kids are driving out to Pittsburgh to work the Taylor Swift concert. And my first comments to them were, try to soak it all in and just be careful. That's really all I care about. Where are you sleeping? I have weird questions.
He made it home from the Cyprus. Grecian Isles and all of the, political upheaval and all the crazy caracatus nuts.
He did say
to
me, hey, Mom, thank you for not calling me on my first day there when Israel was being bombed. And I was like,
I did call. I just let it go straight to prison.
I said, sweetheart, I crawled under the covers and I've been rocking with diarrhea ever since. Hey, I had my first solid poop when my kid came home. Like, that was good, right?
Good for you, my mom.
Also could be the chaga that I'm drinking in the peach honey form and gummy form.
Well, good for you, and good for your digestive tract, whatever's left of it.
So do you think Melissa with her supplements is similar to the Etsy face spell?
No, not in the slightest.
Okay, good.
Well, I was going to say there is some level of scientifically documented clinical study of the ingredients
of
you're ingesting and
right.
the proven result that they produce. It may be nominal result, but there is some consistent, replicable result.
So says the FDA.
Well, it's not regulated by the FDA, but my point is, there's the USB is another one that I'm sure you've got a USB sticker on your stuff. In any event, somebody studied this shit at once or twice and however much now you say, I got to figure out what the study's worth. You know what? It do no harm. So if grooving on mushrooms is making you feel like you can swing your tail feather, rock that shit. Who gives a flippity fuck? Why have money if you can't buy creepy, muddy mushrooms to stuff in your face? Why have the money?
And that is the title of our episode. Dear listener, I promise I'll get my sound better. I'm hiding from dogs in a corner. So we'll perfect this because I plan on recording from the beach for most of the
summer. I'm shutting you up. Just shut up. I'm telling everybody right now. This woman is so lovely. She is so peachy and perfect, even with her quizzical brow and scowling face.
Are you talking about me?
Yes! Who the fuck else would I be talking about? She is a dream in a bottle. She's making this shit happen while she is holed away in her seaside mansion just for us.
We're
going to
do it together
us.
Here, too. That's going to be great.
Chica, 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 amiga! Oh, my God. I got to tell you, I don't speak any Spanish. One of the kids took Spanish in high school.
Yeah.
And he's as good as saying he doesn't speak any Spanish. Well, so all he was saying was like these nonsensical phrases, and he would tell it to me.
Don't
like
I was on la biblioteca.
He would say, he would say like, me gusta la chuga, a la chupo. Like he would say things like, I love lettuce in my butt. Like, and I'm saying all this stuff to the driver. Like, I don't know. And he's looking at me, ¿qué?
Why are you repeating what he is saying?
Because I would say, how do you say? And then I would say whatever I'm trying to say. Right? And I just didn't know any better. And then, of course, then they're in the back going, me gusta lechuga. And they're all saying it in these asshole. And then the driver's laughing his head off. He's aware that they're teenage boys. He's aware that I just said the sentence, how do you say? He's aware that I'm an idiot. He could tell. He could tell all these things.
When you tell him you like lettuce in your butt, I'm guessing.
I kept saying is, muy más macho estúpido. That's all I would say. And I would point to the teen. And then he would, and he would laugh. Muy, muy estúpido. Imbecilo. Excelente.
I feel like you're pulling Italian in there, and that works.
I don't know. I can pronounce things when they would say it. I would repeat it back to them, and my pronunciation is pretty good. So then they would always, halfway through the trip, they would start saying things like, they would ask me in Spanish if I speak Spanish. I forget how they would say it.
Habla español.
Because I would say, I would get three or four things rolling in a row like, hey, how are you? Good morning. Or nice to see you. Or, thanks for having it. Whatever the things was, I got those down, and then I would be saying them. And I would always do the order in Spanish, and then they would respond to me back in Spanish, and I would smile and nod, and they would go, some Spanish? And then I would
they
go,
know exactly
no.
what that smile and nod means.
And then they would come back. I'm well, because in the beginning, I would say, hola, and they would say, hello. Like, they just knew immediately. And then I was like, I don't like that part. So then I thought I could get it rolling, and then I fucked us both, because then I would get into this place like, oh, she knows. No, you don't know shit. So we had that little dance. I'm used to that. I'm used to people thinking I know something and then learning I don't. I feel like that's the basis of this podcast.
Uh-oh. Here's what we do know. We do know that we are grateful for you. Thank you for turning us on. I hope we turned you on at least a little, especially when Amy was talking about the viscous celadon vomit that she had coming out on the boat.
Light frothy foam.
I hope you learned from her. If you see a boat capsize, don't take the next one, you fucking idiot. I would prefer you do a little Duolingo before going on a trip in a country that does not share your language. And come back next week, because I promise you the weather will get better. I promise you the spell we are currently casting on you just by listening to this will improve both your appearance and the way you feel about yourself.
That's true.
And come back and see us sometime. We love you guys.
That's true. Bye!
Bye.
That was the thing I didn't want to do, because now you're going to use it against me because it's super gross. Don't put that in. Nobody likes that. I certainly don't. I like to pretend that I never have gastrointestinal distress.